Department of Nephrology. He is a research guide for 15 PhD scholars, career and research guidance provided for 25 DM nephrology super specialty postgraduates in Sri Ramachandra University. Ongoing research on newer dialysis membrane with the funding of 58 lakhs from Department of Science, Government of India. Ongoing project on herbo mineral formulation for urolithiasis funded by Department of Ayush, Government of India. He has publication of nephrology articles in 21 international and 26 national journals. He has been awarded with Lifetime Achievement Award from NJR Medical University. He is a member governing council, Indian Council of Medical Research. Awards from various professional organizations. He is a member in many Indian and international societies, including a life member of Indian Medical Association, Chennai Kodambakkam branch. I am proud to present Professor Sundar Rajan today to you. Thank you, sir.
Respected senior members of the faculty, all the office bearers of Indian Medical Association, Kodambakkam branch, I feel it's a proud and privilege and honor to stand before senior doyens like Dr. Ramachandran, Dr. Chandrasekharan, and Haruna. I appreciate Dr. Arunachalam for honoring people like senior people like Haruna. It's a rare gesture. I think it's a good gesture. It should continue. It's a very landmark effort by Indian Medical Association, Kodambakkam. Many people like that must be identified in society and honored. I appreciate your effort on that point. The subject of the day, another important I stand with before you with my fond memories about Dr. R. Bhogonada. I like to call him as R. Bhogonada, that's how he was popularly known. Pardon me, he belonged to the generation when people used to have the tag of a community behind him as a pride. He never shut it down till probably till his last time, probably 5 years back, obviously. So I was introduced, I happened to meet him in, I was a postgraduate of Madurai Medical College, so I happened to meet him for the first time. That's how I know him, and subsequently, when I moved to Madras Medical College as a postgraduate, and that conversation, I could meet him in some of the meetings of API. I used to come regularly and attend. Personally, I went and invited him to ASA Hospital. My marriage, he was there probably to bless me at my marriage. Ganani used to refer me patients to Kilpak Medical College, to Tanjore Medical, to Ramachandra Medical College. I used to get references from him with a neat description of the case findings, clinical impression, investigation, and what he wanted. That's the pattern of reference that Mr. Nada used to send me. And he promptly, I have to reply him elaborately, and he will call me and ask me some issues, and he will clarify. The role model physician for next generation to follow, referring a patient, do the needful, and forget about the patient. He used to follow the patient, he used to treat, and Nainar Pandian, Mr. Nainar Pandian was one of his first reference, I remember, which he followed with me. He used to send me promptly every 3 months, 6 months, whenever I asked him. That man lived with a CKD for almost 18 years and subsequently died of myocardial infarction. So I think with the great memories, I think he used to sit in the first row in API meetings, IMA meetings, all the CMEs I used to see. Dr. Ramam sir, and he was a director professor, I used to have the occasion to talk to him. And one of the invited speakers for his CMEs. I salute his memories because as a diabetologist, senior physician, committed to serving the middle class and lower class with great empathy and poor, he used to send me to with the reference saying that he's poor, do the needful. He was serving all class of society. That's one of the great qualities of I'm here. Happy his son, Dr. Mohan, is here. He will emulate his father in the years to come and excel him in his qualities. I pray wholeheartedly at my prayers and salute his memories of Dr. Mohan. It's purely coincidental. I don't know why Dr. Chandrasekharan sir called me 2 days back and told me that Sandarayan, I'm going to link it to this oration. So it's I'm very fortunate this coincidence happened. I could recall the memories of Dr. Mohan at this occasion. So coming to the subject of the day, I feel humbled to stand before you and talk on a subject like when to refer a patient. All of us know, I think, when to refer a patient. A lot of newer ideas have come in the last few years about referring a patient to specialists. You know, as somebody said, evidence-based medicine, experience-based medicine, referring early, referring late. all these issues are there. Some scientific informations have come to tell in the area of nephrology when to refer a patient. It's then what it used to be in the past and what we used to do. When I started my practice in Tanjore Medical College in 84 or 88, there used to be a very senior physician. He used to say, refer my patient. He used to call me. Very due respects to me, because this senior physician one day called me around 10 p.m. Dr. Swaminathan, come with me, I'm going to see a patient. He took me 3 hours of journey. We reached Vadaratim seashore in a coconut, in a farm. A man was lying in candlelight. I examined him, took him his pyelonephritis, treated him, gave him some prescription. Came back, I forgot. He gave me some pieces, my visiting fees. Promptly, very senior physician. I didn't know that. 2 days later, the CBI, CID inspector was in my house. Doctor asked me, Doctor, where did you travel 2 days back last night? In this vehicle? We were followed and we went to this place. And we were the person whom you treated, are you aware? I don't know. Because the man was in dark, very wearing a lungi and a banyan. We were seeing him only in candlelight and torchlight. I didn't even know. I don't know his profile. I treated a patient because I was accompanied by a senior physician. He asked me to come with me to the station. The person who you are treated is none other than Mr. Velupillai Prabhakaran. So come with me to the station. Then I have to use my father-in-law's tag saying that I'm so and so. I cannot come with you for station for treating a patient. So promptly I phoned up to that senior physician. So he rushed to my house and said, no, there's nothing wrong in treating a patient. He has been treated, we have treated him, given a prescription, everything else. I only took him. So he stood with me. So he took me for a reference. When he stood with me, before my father-in-law can interfere, he interfered and saved me from an embarrassment of going and answering in the court. So late referrals are very common, as you are aware. Most of the time, referral is done very late when the patient develops complications. Patient develops convulsion, uremia, unconscious. You refer it to somebody to manage or order for it. I used to say humorously, 3 things somebody orders. You order for an ambulance, or order for a mortuary van, order for a father to come and do the last prayer, and also send a reference letter. Whatever patient prefers, you desire it. That should not require no reference. So almost its late referral has been there for all these years. And patients already developed bulimic complications, bleeding, convulsion, edema, unconsciousness, ultimately ends up in an ICU, do an emergency dialysis, keep them in ventilator, multi-organ dysfunction, give them a huge bill at the time of discharge, and you are not able to save the patient. That's the usual situation what we face all these years. Now the thinking today is about, so what are the problems? Why should we talk about the complications of late referral? Obviously, late referral results in increased morbidity and mortality. Above all, the hospital bills, the hospitalization in the ICUs and the hospital bills, emergency dialysis, all this ends up in a huge bill for the patient in terms of late referral, which can have been done electively by electively placed AV fistula, which can save lakhs of rupees for the patient. So I think the thinking today is about asking for right time to refer a patient. When actually you should refer a patient of chronic kidney disease? What's the correct time? When you should do the right referral? There are some scientific facts that have come. Early referral to nephrologists improved patient survival. That's the bottom line. There are need for early referral. There are so many scientific facts are coming up in orderly patients, which you should justify the need for early referral. I think what are the reasons for early referral is not to make the nephrologist if in the country, you know, you'll be surprised to know when I started nephrology. I joined nephrology, probably I was one of the sixth or seventh postgraduate. I was fourth or fifth postgraduate in Madras Medical College. At that time, there were hardly about 300 nephrologists. Subsequently, it became 800 nephrologists. Believe me, today, even today, there are only 1,400 or 600 nephrologists in the whole country. So you start referring everything nephrologists, all the fellows will die of myocardial infarction. That's not our infarction. So I think late referral, the referral is not for that. I think in terms of outcome, it really does matter, I think. That's the point about doing early referral. Earlier the better. You refer the patient, there's a good scope for communication with the primary physician and the caregiver and the nephrologist in terms of planning things like planning an AV fistula, identifying a donor, identifying a dialysis, the modality of dialysis, going to the hemodialysis, peritoneal dialysis, and how long you can keep them away from dialysis. Above all, you keep them away from the so-called quacks. I think very common. I think this We always say many of my patients, I did have interest in studying than mother have done Ramsar Medical College, almost one of the non-medicals. Did have, so I was saying that 80 to 90% of my dialysis patients have gone to FI, and 60% of them by taking medicine without my knowledge. Because they didn't want to be, because those fellows tell, you take dialysis along with this, you take this. That's the way things are. I think early referral gives us a communication opportunity to put into all these difficulties can be overcome by this early referral. So I went talk about few lines about the current scenario. This is my outline of talk, why you should do, and some new ideas have come about. I could kidney three and why it should be done very early in our patient's side. This is about the number of patients. So you'll be surprised to know from Kashmir to Kanyamari every day, 2 lakh patients are suffering from end-stage kidney failure. 2 lakh patients are coming for every year. I think there are 2 lakh new patients need dialysis and treatment. 2 lakh patients need new cases every year. There's an approximate statistics. Out of which only 1,000 need, 1,000 of patients are on dialysis. 1 lakh is on dialysis. Only 40% get into all these, hardly see nephrologists, because nephrologists are rare species. They're not available everywhere, because kidney specialists are not available everywhere, and ultimately land up with the primary care physician and general physician, which is not wrong, it's not in the country. Every primary physician must be oriented to identifying problem, spotting and interaction with the specialist and send them. Out of these 40% who need consult a nephrologist, hardly 5% get transplanted. 10% goes for dialysis. So what is the fate of these people? They all allowed to die. When I write ESRD in the OPD, I always feel I'm writing a death sentence. Like ESRD in a common man is always equal to a sentence. This can be overcome by identifying problems early. Looking at some few case scenarios which we see, just make a brief. Hypertensive, diabetic, smoking, this patient. And I think this is a commonness. Hypertension and diabetes almost constitutes 2/3 of our patients of chronic kidney disease today. Number one is diabetes, next probably is hypertension. So I think with this patient, you want to order for a screen of kidney. What tests you do is a common thing we ask. I think, what is that we should do order? I think, should you screen this patient for a kidney problem? Yes, we should do. What are the tests we have, well, conventionally we have been doing? Serum creatinine and blood urea. Now we have moved on to newer areas and we're looking at eGFR. This terminology we should familiar, because Google friendly patients comes to you. They search, do a Google search and come and ask me. Somebody asked me last 2 weeks back, somebody asked me, like a patient wants to know what is my blood sugar, fasting, postprandial, cholesterol. This patient doesn't look like a usual over talkative patient. Very humble, simple patient asks me, doctor, what is my eGFR? So that's the knowledge today. I think my patient asks about eGFR, my doctor doesn't know about eGFR. So when you, I think I will be happy if you just go to the Google store and make a, there is a downloads are available. My professor of preventive medicine, doing a large scale survey on eGFR, has created an app. It is downloadable. It's available at GFR India. I am the research guy for him. One day has identified, he has created a GFR India. It's for Indian patients for the first time. Those are for interested, download. It is comparable to your all the existing formulas. Try it up and see. This is very useful for dosing the drugs when patients come to the place. Very accurate, easy to target, high weight, sex, and you can just press it, it will tell you the eGFR, available as GFR India by Dr. Pankaj. Dr. Pankaj is HOD of Alternative Medicine Ramchandra. He has developed the software, is available, it's freely downloadable. Some of you are interested can do that. It's probably where we talk about the simple tests like creatinine. All of us have been estimating creatinine, because these patients whom I mentioned, this creatinine was 1.3. Somebody has got a creatinine of normal. Does it mean the renal function is normal? We all presume that 0.8 to 1.2 and 1.3 is normal. Normal creatinine does not guarantee normal renal function, because that's the message I want to tell you, especially in long-standing diabetic and hypertensive patient. Don't get misled by normal creatinine, because higher side of normal creatinine, 1.3, 1.4, 1.5, 44 urea, look at this, you start presume as high renal insufficiency here, take it as simple dehydration. I think we should look at deeper sense in especially high-risk patients have diabetes, hypertension. Look beyond creatinine. That's the message I want to say. Look beyond creatinine. Don't get misled and give them routine dose of garamycin or aminoglycoside. You will end up with acute renal failure. So I think the second thing is, this patient's creatinine is normal. Look at this patient's eGFR. Calculate the eGFR. GFR is 56 ml per minute. This patient, you give them 80 mg garamycin BD,
you will end up with acute renal failure. So the higher levels of within normal range, higher side of normal range, please have a suspicion of renal insufficiency. That's the message we like to say. Select cases we may like to do ice nuclear scans, protein C, etc., which I am not going to emphasize on this patient. So I think renal function is normal despite a normal creatinine. That's the message you should know. It is a case for estimating, looking, calculating the eGFR, simple by height, weight, and sex, and just press it, you get the eGFR. You can easily interpret the level of eGFR and grade them to the state of chronic kidney disease. That's the message. So because there are so many fallacies, I think we have been taught about all these things in undergraduate days. The fallacies of going by creatinine, most important is the muscle mass, and especially diet, etc. I think there's a very important muscle mass. All these factors can give a spurious creatinine in select situation. I think we should be aware of these problems estimated. I think what is the way of looking at the renal function will be today, you should beyond creatinine always estimate eGFR, plus you should estimate urine protein. I think these three things will suffice to say somebody's kidney status is normal or abnormal along with an ultrasound. Probably you can add an ultrasound to this. All these three, four tests will complete a simple assessment of a kidney function test for a patient whom you want to assess the renal function. So I think proteinuria, I'm not going to see another fallacy today. We have all of us do is once protein estimation is, urine test is normal, we will see no proteinuria. All, please remember conventional heat, the proteinuria to be positive by your dipsticks, or a heat violation, the protein excretion must be more than 300 milligram. So protein excretion is less than 300 milligram, your usual test will be negative. So especially the protein excretion less than 300 milligram, what falls in the range of 30 to 300 milligram is microalbuminuria is important, the earliest marker for kidney disease, especially diabetic patient. I think you want to see a diabetic patient is getting into renal problem or not, please order for this microalbumin test, which will not be detected by the conventional your heat coagulation method or dipsticks method, which is available as microal test, which you can get a clue. The usual test shows some trace. That's the case you should ask for a microalbumin test. All diabetic patients must have a microalbumin test at least every 6 months. If it is type 1, if it is type 2, it's initially on diagnosis and subsequently every 6 months know the proteinuria is there in the marker. But if you catch them at this point of time, these patients' renal dysfunction is completely reversible. Diabetic nephropathy is completely reversible. You catch them at the stage of microalbuminuria and put them on correct control of diabetes and blood pressure. These patients' renal problem can be prevented from further progression. That's the point of looking for microalbuminuria in these type of patients. See, this is another test some of the laboratories are already doing in Chennai. I think some laboratories have started doing cystatins. We have been talking about blood urea and creatinine for centuries. I think now, beyond serum creatinine, if anything has come, yes, serum cystatin C has come. Especially in GFR less than 60 ml per minute. This test is very useful for identifying renal dysfunction, but it's in place of, so even before the serum creatinine rise, cystatin C is come. Other newer biomarkers have come, I'm not going to the details. Right? At least you should be familiar, there's one more test beyond creatinine has come, that is cystatin C is available. Coming to this patient, look at this patient's problem. So this patient who has a diabetic and hypertensive, the screening is mandatory for kidney, because this patient's eGFR slow, creatinine is 1.3, eGFR is 56 ml, protein excretion is less than 30. This would have been missed if you had done a routine urine examination. So this patient obviously has got a kidney problem. So this patient's problem is probably chronic kidney disease. So even with the serum creatinine 1.3, we like to look up for all these interesting factors. This is the time you should order for an ultrasound, all patients have ultrasound. All patients suspected chronic disease, ultrasound will give us a clue about chronicity, especially reduction in the kidney size and loss of CMV. This is necessary to confirm. I think urine exam, beyond urine examination and serum creatinine, eGFR ultrasound examination is necessary. And this patient must be initiated measures by a primary care physician. Even at that point of time, how we can prevent these patients creatinine from 1.3 to becoming 5 or 6 or 8, ending up from dialysis. So that must be the point you should think about, initiating measures for retarding progression of chronic kidney disease. That's possible only if referred to a nephrologist. Please refer to them. American Diabetic Association puts a cutoff as 1.4. And this is no fear of, definitely we should have a decency to send back the patients to you and see it only when as and when necessary, not holding the patient. That's the point of interaction. It must start at that point so that these patients can be delayed for ending up into chronic kidney disease requiring dialysis transplantation. Believe us, this 1.3 becomes 5.6, 5 or 6 or 8 and comes to for dialysis. Two-thirds of these patients before they reach 6 or 8 reaching dialysis end up with cardiovascular complications and die. Since what says at 1.3, 1.4, before we reach the nephrologist for dialysis and transplantation, 2/3 of these early kidney disease develop myocardial problems, coronaryopathies, and die. The cardiovascular the screening must start at that point of time. So all CKDs must be screened for CAD, coronary artery disease, and all coronary artery disease patients must be screened for CKD. That's the teaching we do today. CKD must be screened for CAD, and all CAD must be screened for CKD, so that these patients, cardiovascular prevention can start at that point of time. That also requires a cardiologist referral to look at for, looking for so-called non-traditional risk factors so that coronary artery disease can be prevented this type of patient. That's the importance of doing things. And this patient, same patient, look at this patient, within another 6 months, this patient was followed up, from repeat tests were done, and these patients were followed up in another 6 months' time. And this patient obviously ended up with progressive chronic kidney disease, and this patient was referred to nephrologist at that point of time. I think ultimately ended up with chronic kidney disease and ended up with dialysis. So I think that's the point about illustrative case, about need for early referral in this type of patients. So I think no longer creatinine, as I mentioned, as I said, you should do a combination of creatinine, estimated VFR, albumin creatinine ratio, and ultrasound examination for minority. And this patient, believe me, within six months, what started as 1.3, 1.4 creatinine, within 6 months, this patient's creatinine went up to 3.5, or could drop. And this point, at that point of time, ultimately, he ended up with referring to the nephrologist, and this patient, sooner or later, ended up with dialysis, took some painkiller, came with again another month's time, ended up with dialysis, and ultimately going for a complication of a ESRD and regular maintenance dialysis. That's the speed it goes. What started 1.5 ended up in 6 months' time because of lack of care and the subsequent timely referral. So I think requires immediate referral. So that's about the story of identifying a chronic kidney disease early so that these patients can be prevented for going for cardiovascular complication, number one. Preventing, delaying the need for dialysis and transplantation, number two. Look beyond serum creatinine, look at EGFR, look at cystatin C, so that these patients' problems will be identified. That's one part of the story about CKD. So I think second thing is about acute kidney failure. We all of us happen to see a lot of acute renal failures. Today it's called acute kidney injury. ARF today is called AKI, acute kidney injury. Is a we have been told in our undergraduate days that acute kidney renal failure almost always recover. Don't believe that. So that concept is changed. Acute renal failure is not acute, completely innocuous. It's not complete recovery most of the time. Today, we all know that if you look at 100 cases of chronic renal failure, at least 40% are diabetic, 20% is hypertension, chronic glomerulonephritis, blah, blah. Like that, we have a group of cases called 10%, which we call it as acute renal failure of unknown etiology or unclear etiology. Now we know the so-called acute renal failure of unknown or unclear etiology of 10%, 5% of these patients are previous acute kidney injuries. Now these are the patients who have suffered an acute renal failure in the past, has to be followed in the years to come for a future chronic kidney disease. That's a message we'd like to convey to you, because don't leave your patients and lose them from follow-up, because these patients are potential chronic kidney disease in the years to come. Because AKI is a potential predisposing factor for chronic kidney disease. That's a message we'd like to pass on to you. All AKI, especially childhood AKI, the high risk of chronic kidney disease, these patients, they should be followed up, because reduced renal mass will be a point for progressive CKD, will progressive CKD become in the years to come. That must be the way it should be followed up. I think this is, see, the third important thing is about the prevalence of acute kidney injury in ICU. This is very common. Almost 60% of our patients in multidisciplinary ICUs develop AKI. I'm sure it's everybody's experience, those of you are all your own hospitals and nursing home. Acute kidney injury, so called pre-renal, common is still pre-renal, is still common, as I'm not saying. Still 80%, that is 60-70% of the acute kidney injury is common. So acute kidney injuries in the ICUs must be properly evaluated and followed so that these patients do not miss the chance of getting a specialist consultation. Because the reason for looking for an acute kidney injury must be, so acute kidney injury is half of the patients develop AKI, as common, but is common as respiratory failure, more common than as frequent as shock and ARDS, and these patients must be identified, etiology must be identified, because these patients can be a future potential chronic kidney disease patient. Because we definitely have a role looking at acute kidney injuries in ICUs, one consultation is important, because timely referral of acute kidney injury, we can identify all these factors, especially pre-renal an obstructive, treatable, completely curable means you can learn from looking for a fluid volume deficit, relieving an obstruction. These are all completely reversible. Now these areas of treatable conditions can be obviously identified, and these patients can be properly managed so that these patients do not end up with a future chronic kidney disease. I think that also requires a referral. So I think with immediate referral, because AKA is preventable, treatable, reversible, these risk factors or future chronic kidney disease can be prevented. I think this is a message about don't ignore AKA from referring to a nephrologist at least once, because that may be an important point for identifying or preventing a future chronic kidney disease. That's, I think, the message. Now AKA and chronic kidney disease are integrated clinical syndromes. The early timely referral is necessary, and post-acute renal failure management follow-up is necessary, because these patients can end up with chronic kidney disease in future. Another important problem which we see in our day-to-day practice, because I want to talk about this, because all proteinuria in a diabetic is not diabetic nephropathy. Please do not presume that proteinuria and diabetes diabetic nephropathy. I think I want to highlight this, because all of us treat diabetes. It's not common. Almost now we know, still yes, diabetic proteinuria is almost always diabetic nephropathy, unless proved to be otherwise, only in type 1 diabetes. Type 2 diabetes, so-called non-diabetic causes of proteinuria must be looked for by every one of us, because they are all potentially treatable and curable. I think we routinely look for these non-diabetic causes. At least 30 to 40% of cases of proteinuria non-diabetic type 2 is due to non-diabetic origin. I think this patient, nothing prevents a patient from diabetic, from developing a post-infiltrating glomerulonephritis, minimal change in a product syndrome, minimal or a membranous nephropathy, or a tubular disease, or as other lupus, or it could be a vasculitis, or a drug abuse complication. I think do not presume all proteinuria in a diabetic as a diabetic nephropathy. Please look for non-diabetic causes. What's the way you can do a bedside examination is always look for a fundus examination for retinopathy. Recall our teachers have taught us edema and a proteinuria and a diabetic. Look at the fundus. Fundus, I always say eye and kidneys are cousin brothers. If your retinopathy is there, you can always presume a nephropathy. I think retinopathy with a dilated fundus, because it starts in the periphery, you can see ourselves or send it to an ophthalmologist who will do that for you. The early enough retinopathy is there, that's the case. You need not do biopsy. That's what we have been taught in all these years. We know today more need for doing biopsy in diabetic nephropathy, because so-called non-diabetic nephropathy incidence is quite high, and these patients do require an ophthalmologist examination to rule out a early retinopathy, and also a nephrologist referral, because these patients' non-diabetic causes can be identified and they can be treated in this type of patient. The renal retinal relations, we all know that. See, if you can see here in this slide, 42, the retinopathy incidence in this type 1 is 90%, whereas type 2 diabetic patients, retinopathy incidence can be 40 to 70%. I think there's a good case for looking for non-diabetic patients. 60% of the patients with type 2 diabetes still can have proteinuria not due to diabetic causes. Other than non-diabetic causes, these causes can be identified only if you do a timely kidney biopsy, and more biopsies are necessary in proteinuric diabetic patients to look for non-diabetic causes, because they are potentially reversible. It's very useful for very important message I want to tell in this patient, because kidney biopsy is the only way to look for looking for non-diabetic causes. You can treat them and you identify them early. So early referral is a positive message which you want to, because it ultimately helps the patient, gives them a good clinical outcome. In patients have long-term chronic kidney disease, you can plan your dialysis, you can plan your CRISPR, you can plan your transplant, you can plan your preventive transplant, etc. If you diagnose a chronic kidney disease, above all, diagnose them very early, you can prevent them from going for a cardiovascular complication, which takes away 2/3 of our chronic kidney disease before they come to the nephrologist for dialysis transplantation. That's the message about looking for early referral. I think take home message, last part of my slide, early referral is mentioned in all diabetic hypertensive patients. Don't look at only creatinine, look at the degree of proteinuria, and also look for your eGFR calculation. Anyone who crosses higher side of normal creatinine, always estimate GFR. All diabetic patients require the nephrologist referral when the serum creatinine exceeds more than 1.4, so that you can spot chronic kidney disease early, so you can initiate measures which can retard progression of chronic kidney disease. The need for dialysis, the need for transplantation can be delayed in such type of patients. I think the other thing must be the GFR estimation and proteinuria estimation. looking at things, and that's the way you look for the, all these parameters are there, and this may be, somebody has got a family history of kidney disease, that patient must be sent early, because family history of stones, this must be sent early. These are some of the indications for looking for early referral. And the last part of the slide, I think, early as a referral, we have adequate time, 3 to 6 months time for pre-dialysis education. We educate patients about diet, vaccination, hepatitis B vaccination, pneumococcal vaccination, sparing the veins from venipuncture, from puncturing by nightingales, you know, the endoscopic emergency, IV cannulas. By the time they come to us, all veins are butchered, then we are end up doing a perm cath, or we have to end up doing some or a graft, etc. The veins can be preserved. We always educate our nurses pre-ESRD-CKD. Sparing the veins is important for us. There may be a need for creating AV fistula. I always tell them that all patients coming with raised urea creatinine, use light isocreatinine, start sparing the left upper limb from many punctures. That may be a case for creating an AV fistula as necessary. There is, you can plan your access, you can plan your modality of dialysis, you can do a preemptive dialysis. And I always look for preemptive dialysis because all patients cannot wait for ESR. You have fund, you have money, you have a donor. It's a good case for especially children. You go for a preemptive transplant. The money spent on dialysis can be saved by going for a preemptive transplant. That's possible only by early referral and early consultation. I think, thank you very much for your listening. I'm happy.
What a wonderful talk, sir. Really great. You beautifully compared the contemporary thinking with the newer advances, with the current concepts, and brought it out so beautifully that all of us understand that patient-centric, we will work up the patient better and still refer early to you and not swamp you with the cases because you are a rare breed and we all want to preserve you. Thank you.
And then that, for the